Recorded Books presents Race First, The Ideological and Organizational Struggles of Marcus Garvey and the Universal Negro Improvement Association by Tony Martin. Narrated by Beresford, Bennett. Preface. This book is based on the simple premise that no one could have organized and built up the largest black mass movement in Afro-American history in the face of continuous onslaughts from communists on the left, black reactionaries on all sides, and the most powerful governments in the world, and yet be a buffoon or a clown or even an overwhelmingly impractical visionary. Distortions are not new to Afro-American history, but one would be hard-put to find a major black figure who has suffered more at the hands of historians and commentators. This study attempts to treat Marcus Garvey and the Universal Negro Improvement Association with the seriousness and respect which they deserve. After a brief biographical introduction, the study examines the major features of Garvey's ideological outlook as they manifested themselves both in theory and in practice. The last and longest portion of the book is taken up with an examination of the formidable battles which the UNIA was simultaneously involved in on a variety of fronts. Despite the personal animosities generated by these struggles, they were essentially ideological conflicts, for Garvey's revolutionary nationalism was perceived as a threat by a wide spectrum of opponents who had little affection for each other outside of their common desire to crush Garvey and extirpate his movement. Against all these disparate forces, Garvey prevailed, and it was only with his deportation from the United States that his organizational grip on the black masses in North America and to varying degrees elsewhere slowly began to loosen. Even then, his ideological legacy continued to be a major force in black communities. A large number of people helped me in a large number of ways, big and small, during the years that this book slowly took shape. I thank them all. In particular, I would like to mention four professors who provided much encouragement during and after my sojourn as a graduate student at Michigan State University, when the foundations for this book were laid. They are Professors James R. Hooker, Joseph McMillan, Harold G. Marcus, and Ruth Hamilton. I would also like to include a special word of appreciation for the inspiration provided by the several persons with whom I spoke who had been active UNIA members in Garvey's day. They are the late Mrs. Amy Jakes Garvey of Kingston, Jamaica, Mr. J. Charles Zampti, once of Trinidad, but for over a half century of Detroit, Michigan, a founder of the Detroit UNIA and one-time auditor to Garvey, Mr. J.R. Ralph Casimir of Roseau, Dominica, leader in the post-World War I years of the Dominica UNIA, and one of the most active and influential of West Indian Garveyites, Queen Mother Moore, who saw Garvey in New Orleans in 1922, Colonel Von Dinsey of New York, and the several members of the New York Vanguard local and the Detroit UNIA with whom I chatted. Thanks also to Mr. Herbert Whiteman, friend of Kwame Nkrumah, the Schomburg Center for Research in Black Culture, the New York Public Library, Astor, Lennox and Tilden Foundations, for materials used in the appendix, and to the Association for the Study of Afro-American Life and History, for materials contained in Chapter 9, which originally appeared in an article in the Negro History Bulletin. To the fool or fools in Harlem who broke into my car, ripped off my first 6 months' notes, and forced me to start over my research, I say, why didn't you take the spare tire instead, man? June 1975, Tony Martin. Chapter 1. Introduction. Marcus Mosiah Garvey, 1887 to 1940. What do I care about death in the cause of the redemption of Africa? I could die anywhere in the cause of liberty. A real man dies but once. A coward dies 1,000 times before his real death. So we want you to realize that life is not worth its salt except you can live it for some purpose. And the noblest purpose for which to live is the emancipation of a race and the emancipation of posterity. Marcus Garvey. History records that slaves, by virtue of their experiences and the knowledge gained in captivity in strange lands, have eventually become masters of themselves and in time enslaved others. Let us, therefore, use adversity as others have done. Take advantage of every opportunity. Where there is none, make it for yourself. And let history record that as we toiled laboriously and courageously, we worked to live gloriously. Marcus Garvey. Marcus Mosiah Garvey was born in St. Anne's Bay, Jamaica, on August 17, 1887. His childhood was deeply rooted in the peasant environment, which largely surrounded him. He once described an uncle, for whom he sometimes worked, as a sharecropper. His own parents also engaged in small-scale peasant farming. Garvey's was not a typical peasant experience, however. His father, a descendant of the Maroons, Jamaica's African ex-slaves who successfully defied the slave regime, was also a skilled tradesman, a stonemason. Garvey's background further distinguished him from the typical peasant in that his father possessed a library among whose volumes Garvey developed an early taste for reading. His childhood was characterized by an adequate elementary education, supplemented by private tutors and Sunday school. His leadership ability seems to have manifested itself from the very beginning, for his physical prowess gave him a position of eminence among his peers. At the age of 14, by which time he had already become apprenticed to a local printer, Garvey left school. 2 years later, he moved to Kingston, Jamaica's capital city, where he obtained work. By the time he was 18, he had achieved what he later described as an excellent position as manager of a large printing establishment. This was an outstanding achievement, making Garvey the youngest foreman printer in Kingston, and at a time when many foremen were still being imported from Great Britain and Canada. Participation in a strike, during which he consented to lead the workers despite assurances of favor from management, cost him his job. He then obtained new employment with the government printery. In Kingston, Garvey quickly immersed himself in the intellectual and political life of the city. By 1909, his political involvement had brought him into the National Club, organized by a lawyer and legislative council member, Sandy Cox. Garvey was elected one of the assistant secretaries of this club, which sought to combat privilege and the evils of British colonialism on the island. In 1910, Garvey embarked on the first of his many wanderings in foreign lands. He went to Costa Rica, where he worked for a while as a timekeeper on a United Fruit Company banana plantation, and as a laborer on the pier at Port Limon, edited a paper, La Nación, harassed the British consul concerning his non-protection of the many British West Indian laborers working there, was arrested for urging workers to fight for better conditions, and was eventually expelled from the country, or left to escape the authorities. He continued, for the next year or so, to wander through Latin America, going to such places as Panama and Ecuador, where West Indian workers had migrated in large numbers in search of work. He observed the universal degradation of the black race, worked intermittently to finance his travels, started another small paper in Colon, Panama, and agitated among black workers. A black worker in Colon at the time remembers meeting Garvey around 1912 as he addressed the predominantly black Colon Federal Labor Union. There is a possibility that Garvey may have stopped briefly, perhaps in transit, at a seaport, somewhere in the United States during this period. From Central America, Garvey returned briefly to Jamaica, and by the autumn of 1912, Undeterred by a lack of money, he was in England, where his only surviving sister, Indiana, was working as a governess. In England, he indulged his love of public speaking at Hyde Park's Speaker's Corner, was a regular visitor to the House of Commons, and worked for the Africa Times and Orient Review, the foremost Pan-African journal of the day. He found the time to visit Scotland, Ireland, France, Italy, Spain, Austria, Hungary, and Germany. Garvey said later that he attended some lectures in law at Birkbeck College of the University of London. By July 1913, Garvey was, not surprisingly, almost destitute, and he applied for government assistance. Possibly because of his job at the Africa Times and Orient Review, however, his article for the magazine was published in the October issue, he was able to eke out an existence for almost another year. By May 1914, when he was probably again without employment, the Anti-Slavery and Aborigines Protection Society intervened on his behalf, dispatching him to the Colonial Office with an offer of a contribution from the society if the Colonial Office would put up some of the money to repatriate him to Jamaica. Early in June, the society informed the Colonial Office that Garvey was endeavoring to raise a fund to meet passage money and offered to match equally any amount the Colonial Office proffered. Garvey managed to do without the largesse of these two agencies, however. He succeeded in raising his fare home and left England on June 17, 1914. Garvey's first sojourn in England was of great importance to his career. The workings of British democracy made a lasting impression on him and, like later generations of visitors from the colonized world to the metropolis, he noted the contrast to the autocracy which the very same colonizers maintained in their tropical dependencies. He was often to call, in the years to come, for an extension of British justice to the colonies. England gave him an opportunity, too, to enhance his already wide knowledge of the worldwide sufferings of black people. In the pages of the Africa Times and Orient Review, there appeared regularly articles by and about such leading black figures as Booker T. Washington, Edward Wilmot Blyden, John Edward Bruce, W.E.B. Du Bois, and William Ferris, to name but a few. Some of these would before long be his associates in the United States. Garvey also came into contact with black seamen and students whose sufferings he observed, and with the many people of color who visited the offices of the journal. And the fact that the journal combined a Pan-African outlook with wide coverage of Middle and Far Eastern nationalist struggles, and indeed all anti-colonial struggles, contributed further to Garvey's growth and influenced his future outlook. Garvey arrived back in Jamaica on July 15, 1914, his head bristling with ideas on making a living and founding a racial movement. To secure the former, he tried selling greeting and condolence cards and monumental tombstones. To secure the latter, he formed, 5 days after his arrival, the Universal Negro Improvement and Conservation Association and African Communities Imperial League. The title bore testimony to the enlarged vision brought about by his travels and the fear, which he never relinquished, that weak races were doomed to slavery and possibly extinction. In this regard, he wrote, "For the last 10 years, I have given my time to the study of the condition of the Negro here, there, and everywhere, and I have come to realize that he is still the object of degradation and pity the world over, in this sense that he has no status socially, nationally, or commercially, with a modicum of exception in the United States of America." Garvey became president and traveling commissioner of the new organization, among whose stated objects were the fostering of a universal confraternity among the race, the establishment of a central nation for black people, the setting up of educational institutions, and a pledge to work for better conditions among Negroes everywhere. Amy Ashwood, whom he had met at the weekly meeting of the East Queen Street Baptist Literary and Debating Society, became its secretary. The association was formed, she said, on their second meeting. A few days later, an inaugural meeting took place at the Collegiate Hall, Kingston, presided over by the mayor of Kingston. Recruiting was slow, even though Garvey worked tirelessly and succeeded in establishing himself in the minds of many as an agitator and a nuisance. Many respectable Negroes, who had not yet learned to love their blackness, opposed his movement. As Garvey wrote later, "I had to decide whether to please my friends and be one of the black whites of Jamaica and be reasonably prosperous, or come out openly and defend and help improve and protect the integrity of the black millions and suffer." After about a year, the organization could boast only about 100 members. Up to this time, its activities were largely confined to Kingston. In November 1915, however, its first public meeting outside Kingston was held, in Garvey's hometown of St. Anne's Bay. The Jamaica Times reported, "Right merrily did the people of the town turn out to listen to their fellow townsmen." Garvey had planned to undertake a fundraising lecture tour in the United States beginning this very month, having received an assurance of support from Booker T. Washington. But the latter's death caused him to postpone his trip until 1916. Garvey arrived in New York on March 23, 1916, for a lecture tour which he thought would last 5 months and would be confined to black audiences mostly in the South. He arranged for his mail to be delivered to an address in Jamaica during his absence and let it be known wherever he went in America that he was raising funds for an industrial institute to be established in Jamaica. Garvey's advent into the United States did not find him as much a stranger to conditions there as some are led to believe. For one thing, his wide reading on racial matters had obviously included the race's condition in North America. More than this, though, Garvey's visit to the United States came in the midst of a large-scale migration of West Indians to that country. The to-ing and fro-ing of persons and ideas generated by this migration meant that adapting to the United States was probably not too much of a problem for new arrivals. By March 1916, Garvey's sense of mission, his conviction that he had been called upon to emancipate his race, had developed to an uncanny degree. Shortly before leaving Jamaica, he had written in a letter to Robert Russell Moton, Booker T. Washington's successor at Tuskegee, "I am now talking with you as a man with a mission from the high God." Even though he still thought that Jamaica would be the main field of his exertions, he had nevertheless already mapped out the course he was to follow over the next few years. He wrote in the same letter, "I have many large schemes on my mind for the advancement of my people that I cannot expose at the present to the public, as in such a case, my hope of immediate success would be defeated, as my enemies are so many and they are ever anxious to misrepresent me. I have firstly to found a press of our own and to get some working start so as to demonstrate my true intentions." Once in the United States, Garvey found lodgings with a Jamaican family in Harlem, came down with pneumonia, obtained work as a printer, and saved enough to start out on his fundraising tour through the States. He gave his address at this time as 53 West 140 Street in Harlem. By June, he was lecturing in Boston, and by November, demonstrating again the amazing mobility which had characterized his Central American and European visits. He had already visited, among other places, New York, Boston, Philadelphia, Pittsburgh, Baltimore, Washington, D.C., and Chicago. He had also met a goodly number of prominent national and local Afro-American leaders. Among them were John Edward Bruce, whom he called a true Negro, a man for whom he had the strongest regard, a Dr. R.R. Wright Jr., Dr. Parks, Vice President of the Baptist Union, Dr. Trelay, of the Methodist Episcopal Church of Philadelphia, Reverend J.C. Anderson, whom he described only as being of Quinn Chapel, Mrs. Ida Wells Barnett of anti-lynching fame, magazine editor Fenton Johnson, and William H. Ferris. Bruce had been an agent for and a regular contributor to the Africa Times and Orient Review. Ferris had once written an article for the same magazine in which he praised Garvey's October 1913 article, which had appeared a few months before his. Ferris was later to edit Garvey's weekly Negro World from 1920 to 1923, and to hold a variety of high offices within the UNIA. Bruce, after an initial period of skepticism, became a regular contributor to and member of the editorial boards of both the Negro World and Garvey's Daily Negro Times. Until his death in 1924, he remained the staunchest of Garvey's supporters among the Afro-American intelligentsia. Garvey's whirlwind tour took him through 38 states and lasted about a year. He returned at the end of it to New York City, where he established a temporary base. Harlem, only recently converted into the Black section of New York, was already the virtual capital of the Black world. Its population, composed in the vast majority of Southern and West Indian-born immigrants, was possessed of a rare vitality, containing, as it did, a high proportion of radicals of all types and a large number of outstanding Black creative artists. Race uplift groups of all kinds abounded, and the main thoroughfare, Lenox Avenue, was a favorite haunt of soapbox orators. Harlem, however, was but a microcosm of the Black world of the World War I period. The subjugation of Africa by European imperialism was still a fresh memory. In response to this, an infinite number of nationalist and pan-Africanist organizations had come into being in Africa, Europe, North America, the West Indies, Central and South America, everywhere that Black people lived, and all looking toward the restoration of African independence. Apart from the African question, Black communities everywhere had local problems of their own. The Black man was almost everywhere in a state of subjugation. Garvey, in his involvement in the printer's strike, in his participation in Jamaica's National Club, in his agitation among Black workers in Central America, in his travels in Europe, and in his formation of the UNIA, conservation had dropped out of the title along the way, had long embodied the spirit of Black protest which characterized the age. It was inevitable, therefore, that he should be tempted by Harlem, the most highly politicized Black community in the world. Garvey moved onto the center of the Harlem stage with all the ease and self-confidence of the man with a mission. He took to the streets, joining the soapbox and stepladder orators, and formed political alliances with some of Harlem's prominent radicals. Someone who knew Garvey at this time recalled that he could throw his voice around three corners without batting an eyelash. On June 12, 1917, Harlem intellectual Hubert Harrison invited Garvey to address a mass meeting attended by 2,000 held at the Bethel AME Church for the purpose of organizing Harrison's Liberty League. Garvey himself, before his tour through the states, had held a not-too-successful meeting in the course of which he fell off the platform. The Liberty League meeting was a windfall, however, for he was a tremendous success. Shortly before, or perhaps shortly after, Harrison's meeting, Garvey began to hold weekly meetings of his own every Sunday at 3 p.m. in Harlem's Lafayette Hall at 131 Street, and Lenox Avenue. The meetings were slated to continue until October 1917, and Garvey was still being billed as head of the UNIA and ACL of Jamaica. At one of these Sunday meetings on July 8th, less than a month after the Liberty League gathering, Garvey's address was devoted to a denunciation of the conspiracy of the East St. Louis riots. The first New York branch of the UNIA may already have been formed by this time, for the association's address was given as 235 West 131 Street. The subject of this lecture shows that Garvey had once again demonstrated the propensity, as in Costa Rica and Panama, of quickly becoming embroiled in the purely local issues of wherever he happened to be. Garvey's first UNIA branch in New York, as well as a second attempted early in 1918, was envisaged as being auxiliary to the Jamaica headquarters. Garvey himself, as president of the Jamaica division, did not hold office in them. Both these efforts to establish UNIA branches were disrupted by attempts by socialists and Republicans to turn them into political clubs. On a third attempt based on the wishes of a nucleus of 13 members, Garvey consented to become president of the New York branch, thus concretizing a decision that he had in all likelihood already contemplated, namely to cast down his bucket in the United States. With this move, New York City supplanted Kingston, Jamaica as UNIA headquarters. A schism developed in this new attempt too, but Garvey weathered the storm. The association's meeting place had meanwhile moved from the Lafayette Hall to the Palace Casino, where it remained for most of 1918. Once Garvey had decided to remain in the United States, he moved on with renewed vigor. The UNIA was incorporated under the laws of New York on July 2, 1918. On July 31st, the African Communities League was incorporated as a business corporation. A month or two later, the Negro World appeared, destined to become the most widely circulated of race papers and the bane of European colonialists. Garvey initially edited it. The earliest issues were distributed free by being pushed under people's doors in the early hours. During the year, Garvey embarked on his first fundraising tour outside of New York after moving the UNIA headquarters. His first stop was Detroit, where he was hit in the head by a stone thrown by a heckler. On his return to New York, his secretary, Amy Ashwood, who had accompanied him, was summoned to the district attorney's office a total, she wrote later, of 17 times. The authorities, it seems, suspected Garvey of raising funds for a non-existent Back to Africa enterprise. On November 11, 1918, the New York Times reported a meeting of 5,000 persons presided over by Garvey at the Palace Casino. The meeting celebrated the end of World War I by calling on the Allied powers to hand over the ex-German colonies in Africa to black rule. Several persons, among them socialist A. Philip Randolph and Ida Wells Barnett, were nominated at the meeting to lobby on behalf of the UNIA at the upcoming Paris Peace Conference. The UNIA eventually dispatched a Haitian as High Commissioner to lobby during the conference, since most Afro-Americans were being denied passports to France by the United States government. Shortly after the November meeting, Mrs. Wells Barnett addressed a UNIA gathering in New York. On this occasion, however, she annoyed Garvey by advising against the idea of a return to Africa and the establishment of what was subsequently to become the Black Star Line Steamship Corporation. Like most people who saw Garvey in action, she later testified to the remarkable sway which he exercised over his audience. By 1919, Garvey was already firmly established as one of Harlem's most important radical figures, and it was during this year that his fame spread over the globe. Before the year had ended, he would be regularly discussed in the press and in governmental circles in Europe, Africa, the West Indies, and elsewhere. In March 1919, at another large meeting at the Palace Casino, Garvey claimed that W.E.B. Du Bois had humbugged the activities of his high commissioner in France. The desire for an Afro-American lobby at the Paris Peace Conference was also responsible for bringing together a group of Harlem radicals and other prominent individuals at the home of wealthy but race-conscious Madam C.J. Walker. Garvey was among those present at this meeting, out of which grew the short-lived International League of Darker Peoples. In June 1919, Garvey incorporated his Black Star Line Steamship Corporation. By this time, Garvey claimed later the UNIA had about 30 branches and over 2 million members. This figure apparently included sympathizers as well as members in any strict sense, but the spread of his ideas by this time could not be gainsaid. As early as 1918, the Negro world had been reaching places as far as Panama, and throughout 1919, Garveyites were blamed by colonial authorities for anti-white riots in Jamaica, Trinidad, and British Honduras, among other places. In October 1919, Garvey, fast approaching the peak of his career, had his closest escape from an untimely death. Several shots were fired at him by one George Tyler, two of which found their mark. The wounds were minor, however. Tyler died mysteriously, supposedly jumping to his death from the cell where he was awaiting a court appearance. It was widely suspected that he planned to implicate others in his assassination attempt. A little over 2 months after this attempt on his life, on Christmas Day 1919, Garvey married Amy Ashwood during a lavish spectacle at Liberty Hall, now the UNIA's own meeting place. In 1916, she had left Jamaica for Panama, but had become reunited with Garvey in the spring of 1918, when she moved to the United States. The marriage was over by early 1920, the couple having parted company amid a welter of accusations and counter-accusations concerning infidelity, financial misdealings, and political strategies. The year 1920 witnessed the first International Convention of the Negro Peoples of the World, organized by Garvey. At the opening session at Madison Square Garden, New York, an overflow crowd of 25,000 filled the arena and spilled out into the streets. The other sessions took place in Liberty Hall in Harlem. Delegates who came from all over the Black world adopted the Declaration of Rights of the Negro Peoples of the World. This declaration listed the main grievances of the race and demanded their resolution. Notice was served on European colonialists that the Black man had an inherent right to possess himself of Africa, regardless of the claims of any other race or nation. Demands were made for the capitalization of the N in Negro, for the teaching of Black history in schools, and for an end to lynching and sundry other discriminations. The red, black, and green were adopted as the colors of the race. August 31st, the last day of the month-long convention, was proclaimed an international holiday for Black people, and the universal Ethiopian anthem was adopted. During the course of the convention, Garvey was elected President General of the UNIA and Provisional President of Africa. The mayor of Monrovia, Liberia, Gabriel Johnson, was elected Supreme Potentate, or Ceremonial Leader. Several others were elected leaders of various parts of the Black world. Also, in 1920, was the birth of the UNIA's Negro Factories Corporation, which over the next 2 or 3 years managed a number of UNIA businesses, including laundries, restaurants, a doll factory, tailoring and millinery establishments, and a printing press. Some of these ventures had been in operation since 1918, for Ida Wells Barnett reporting having been shown a UNIA restaurant and some unspecified smaller undertakings by Garvey in that year. By 1921, Garvey was unquestionably the leader of the largest organization of its type in the history of the race. He had succeeded as no one else had in gathering up the worldwide feelings of dismay at the loss of independence and defiance against colonialism and oppression, which characterized the New Negro spirit of the age. As of August 1, 1921, the UNIA contained 418 chartered divisions, up from 95 a year earlier, plus 422 not yet chartered. There were, in addition, 19 chapters, none the previous year, making a total of 859 branches. Garvey's unparalleled success had the effect of arraying against him a most powerful conglomeration of hostile forces. The United States government was against him because they considered all black radicals subversive. European governments were against him because he was a threat to the stability of their colonies. The communists were against him because he successfully kept black workers out of their grasp. The National Association for the Advancement of Colored People and other integrationist organizations were against him because he argued that white segregationists were the true spokesman for white America and because he, in turn, advocated black separatism. His organization also had to contend with unscrupulous opportunists who were not above sabotaging its workings for personal gain. In 1921, opposition from all these forces escalated to a remarkable extent. First, the United States Department of State almost prevented Garvey from re-entering the country after a short trip to the Caribbean area. He managed to make it back, however, barely in time for his second international convention. Then, at his annual convention, the communists, spearheaded by their black auxiliary, the African Blood Brotherhood, made an unsuccessful bid to capture his following. Meanwhile, the NAACP, through its major black spokesman, W.E.B. Du Bois, was steadily increasing its campaign of attacks in its organ, The Crisis, and elsewhere. The black socialists, too, had begun to criticize Garvey, and the British authorities were busy pursuing the policy they had begun in 1919 of banning the Negro world, prohibiting UNIA officials from entering their colonies, and generally doing whatever they could to thwart the spread of Garvey's influence. Finally, on January 12, 1922, Garvey was arrested for alleged mail fraud. This was a signal for redoubled efforts on the part of his enemies, who presumed his guilt and called for his arrest and deportation. Despite all this, the UNIA managed to push ahead. The Daily Negro Times appeared in 1922, and a Black Man magazine was projected, but did not in fact appear until much later. Garvey's second marriage took place during this year, to his private secretary, Amy Jakes. In 1923, he was convicted on the mail fraud charges in connection with the Black Star Line. Yet, Garvey was now claiming a membership of 6 million and 900 branches. 500 of the branches and a little less than half the membership were said to be in the United States. Garvey's last full year as a free man in the United States was 1924. During this year, the remarkable faith which his followers placed in him was again demonstrated when they subscribed enough to launch a new steamship line, the Black Cross Navigation and Trading Company. The year 1924 also saw the blocking of Garvey's intention to set up a base in Liberia. During this year, too, the UNIA launched its Negro Political Union, designed to bring its voting strength to bear on American and other elections by endorsing candidates based on their record of dealings with the race, irrespective of party affiliations. In February 1925, Garvey's appeal was turned down, and he entered the federal penitentiary at Atlanta. What his enemies hoped to obtain through his imprisonment did come to pass. Schisms appeared in the American movement, resulting by 1926 in a splinter in the New York branch, the largest of all, estimated at 35,000 members at one time. These strains occasioned by Garvey's departure were, however, still relatively minor, for Garvey, even from jail, managed to maintain some control, appointing and dismissing officers and conferring with his aides. At an extraordinary conference in Detroit in 1926, the Secretary General, G. Imoni Carter, reported 814 domestic branches, 215 foreign, and 91 new ones, whether foreign or domestic not specified, for a grand total of 1,120. There were 25 pending applications for charters. The discovery in 1970 of UNIA records, including membership files, provides a unique opportunity to verify these figures. According to the data in these records, mostly compiled from about 1925 through 1928, there were 725 UNIA branches in the United States, possibly 723, and 271 outside of the United States, possibly 273, making a grand total of 996. Several interesting and possibly surprising facts emerge from this new information. First of all, if the number of branches in a given area can be taken to indicate the extent of UNIA penetration, then the southern United States was the most thoroughly UNIA organized area in the world. Louisiana was far and away the most thoroughly Garveyite state, with a total of 74 branches. The top three states in the United States were in the South, and only three of the top 13 were in the North. These findings may be tempered somewhat, but only somewhat, by the fact that some of the largest single branches were probably in such northern cities as New York and Chicago. In all, the UNIA was represented in 38 of the United States. It was not only the organization of newly urbanized Afro-Americans. It was also the organization of the great mass of black peasants all over the South, Southwest, and elsewhere. Outside the United States, Cuba led with 52 branches, more than any single United States state except Louisiana. The greater Caribbean area, including Central America and Northern South America, was undoubtedly the biggest Garveyite stronghold outside of the United States. South Africa was the most thoroughly organized of the African countries. No area of significant black population in the world was without a UNIA branch. This included Canada, Europe, and Australia. The data suggests that the Detroit report of 1926 was accurate. The slight discrepancy in figures is probably due to no greater cause than the loss of some membership cards during the decades preceding their rediscovery. For there were branches in such places as Dahomey, the Belgian Congo, and areas in Trinidad, which do not appear among the records. An important conclusion to be drawn from the figures in this chapter is that the UNIA continued to expand after Garvey's 1925 incarceration. Some branches were undoubtedly disbanding, even as new ones were being added, but the evidence as to how many is inconclusive. Certainly, by 1926, some branches were not sending up-to-date information to headquarters, but this had always been a problem and did not necessarily indicate lack of activity in those branches. Meanwhile, the clamor for Garvey's release mounted. At one demonstration in Harlem, an estimated 150,000 people marched and jammed the sidewalks. The government, bewildered by the depth of feeling shown for someone they liked to characterize as a crook, and perhaps viewing with apprehension the upcoming election year, decided to commute his sentence, but with deportation. 5,000 loyal followers were on hand at New Orleans to listen to Garvey's farewell address from the deck of the vessel taking him to the Caribbean. They stood in the rain and sang the UNIA hymn, "God Bless Our President," as the ship pulled away, bearing their leader from the scene of his greatest triumphs, never to set foot in the United States again. When the ship stopped in Panama, Garvey was greeted by a delegation from the local UNIA, and in Jamaica, where he arrived on December 10, 1927, he was given a hero's welcome as some of the largest crowds in the island's history turned out to greet him. None dismayed by his deportation, Garvey set about making the most of his adversity. In 1928, he visited England, presented a renewed petition to the League of Nations, and briefly visited Canada. In August 1929, Garvey held the 6th International Convention in Jamaica. It was as spectacular as the earlier ones in Harlem. A split occurring at the convention resulted in the formation of a separate UNIA Inc., headquartered in the United States. Garvey remained head of his faction, now calling itself the UNIA and ACL, August 1929, of the world. The American schismatics did not carry the whole American field with them. They failed, for example, to win control of the Negro world, which continued to carry Garvey's pronouncements. Units loyal to Garvey often changed their names to Garvey clubs, Ethiopian clubs, and the like, and animosity between the two groups in the United States occasionally led to violence. The year 1929 marked, too, Garvey's most direct incursion into Jamaican electoral politics. Between the convention and the end of the year, he formed the People's Political Party, PPP, began campaigning for a seat in the Legislative Council, was jailed for 3 months for contempt by British judges when he promised to reform the bench if elected, and was elected to the Kingston and St. Andrew Corporation, KSAC, Council, while in jail. Upon his release, the corporation promptly declared his seat vacant, but he was returned unopposed early in 1930. Meanwhile, the British judges convicted him again, this time for supposedly libeling British colonialism in an editorial in his Black Man newspaper. Garvey's bid for the Legislative Council was defeated in January 1930, largely because the majority of the black masses still had no vote under British colonialism. His PPP, nevertheless, successfully placed some candidates in both the KSAC and the Legislative Council. Garvey himself continued to serve on the KSAC Council for the next few years, on one occasion, 1931, being re-elected while out of the country. During this period, Garvey occasionally acted as a de facto trade union leader, taking up the causes of unorganized workers. In 1931, Garvey made yet another trip to England and the League of Nations. Back in Jamaica, he continued to hold political meetings, formed an amusement company, and dabbled in real estate. A 7th International Convention was held in Jamaica in 1934, followed some months later by a shift of his base of operations to England. In England, Garvey contacted African students, harangued the crowds at Hyde Park's Speaker's Corner, and managed to keep together those divisions of the UNIA that had survived the Depression, the schisms following his deportation from the United States, and the inroads into his erstwhile followers, especially in the United States, made by Father Divine, Muslims, the peace movement of Ethiopia, the communists, and diverse other groups. His organization in the United States remained viable, and in 1936, 1937, and 1938, Garvey visited Canada to meet with his North American followers, who would on these occasions cross the border in large numbers and would, among other things, attend Garvey's School of African Philosophy, which provided crash courses for UNIA organizers. After his 1937 visit to Canada, he toured the West Indies, speaking to enthusiastic audiences in St. Kitts, Nevis, Antigua, Montserrat, Dominica, St. Lucia, St. Vincent, Grenada, Barbados, Trinidad, and British Guyana. During his 1938 visit to Canada, he held his 8th International Convention in Toronto from August 1st to 17th. Despite his deportation and despite the increasing fragmentation of his membership, His ideas continue to hold sway among the black masses in America with remarkable tenacity. For one thing, the fragmentation did not always mean a difference in ideology between the various splinter groups. Many of them, such as the peace movement of Ethiopia and the Moorish Americans, continued to regard Garvey as something of a patron saint even after they broke with the UNIA. Garvey died in London in June 1940, active to the end in his efforts to emancipate a race. Chapter 2. Race First and Self-Reliance. In a world of wolves, one should go armed, and one of the most powerful defensive weapons within the reach of Negroes is the practice of race first in all parts of the world. Marcus Garvey. What we believe. The Universal Negro Improvement Association advocates the unity and blending of all Negroes into one strong, healthy race. It is against miscegenation and race suicide. It believes that the Negro race is as good as any other, and therefore should be as proud of itself as others are. It believes in the purity of the Negro race and the purity of the white race. It is against rich blacks marrying poor whites. It is against rich or poor whites taking advantage of Negro women. It believes in the spiritual fatherhood of God and the brotherhood of man. Marcus Garvey. Marcus Garvey, unlike his major rivals in the United States, built a mass organization that went beyond mere civil rights agitation and protest and based itself upon a definite, well-thought-out program that he believed would lead to the total emancipation of the race from white dominion. Central to the ideological basis underpinning Garvey's program was the question of race. For Garvey, the black man was universally oppressed on racial grounds, and any program of emancipation would have to be built around the question of race first. The race became a political entity, which would have to be redeemed. Against the rival suggestion that humanity, and not the black race, should be the objects of his zeal, he argued that it was not humanity that was lynched, burned, Jim Crowed, and segregated, but black people. The primacy of race characterized the UNIA from its beginnings in Jamaica, and by 1919, United States government officials were drawing attention to what they considered this subversive doctrine. Garvey went about the task of converting the disabilities of race into a positive tool of liberation with a thorough aggressiveness. "No man can convince me contrary to my belief," he declared, "because my belief is founded upon a hard and horrible experience, not a personal experience, but a racial experience. The world has made being black a crime, and I have felt it in common with men who suffered like me, and instead of making it a crime, I hope to make it a virtue." Accordingly, the consciousness of Garvey's followers was saturated with the new doctrine. Black dolls were manufactured for black children. Garvey's newspaper proclaimed itself the Negro World. He encouraged his followers to support their black businessmen and professionals. The race catechism used by his followers disabused the minds of black folk concerning the claims of the Hamitic myth by explaining that, contrary to this myth, black people were certainly not the recipients of any biblical curse. He frowned upon advertisements of a racially demeaning nature. The Negro World sponsored beauty contests and published photographs of beautiful black women, a subject on which Garvey waxed poetic. "Black queen of beauty, thou hast given color to the world." Indeed, practically every aspect of the organization was designed to bolster the black man's self-esteem and to foster pride in self. The primacy of race in Garvey's thought was coupled with a deep pessimism concerning the future of the black man in America. He believed that the black man with increasingly ample educational opportunities, would aspire to positions of influence, which would bring him into direct competition with the white power structure. Within 50 to 100 years, he predicted, such confrontation would lead to a racial clash, which would end disastrously for the black race. This analysis led Garvey inevitably in the direction of racial separation. His economic ventures in the United States amounted to an attempt toward a nucleus of a self-sustaining, and therefore self-employing, black race in America. But his gaze looked more longingly toward Africa as the salvation of the African abroad. Even in Africa, though, he found the European overlords attempting to increase the seeds of future racial discord, as in 1938, when he protested British consideration of a proposal to resettle European Jews in Tanganyika, Kenya, or British Guyana. Garvey's concern over the salvation of the race led him to harsh criticism of any weaknesses he perceived among black people, and there was nothing that displeased him more than the black man who did not think in racial terms. Such criticism brought out the finest of his invective. Yes, this an Uncle Tom Negro. Yes, a yes boss Negro. A howdy massa Negro. A yes mas Charlie Negro. A Negro who will be satisfied to blacken a white man's shoes all the days of his life and lick the white man's spittle if he orders him to do so. Garvey's race-first doctrine found excellent expression in his acute awareness of the role of culture as a tool for liberation. He himself was a prolific poet of liberation. Indeed, his poems are as good a source of his ideology as any. They were replete with such themes as the beauty of the black woman, the need for self-reliance, the glories of African history, the necessity for an end to black participation in white wars, and protests at the Italian invasion of Ethiopia. This experimentation with the arts for purposes of politicizing the UNIA membership was also indulged in by one of Garvey's closest associates, John Edward Bruce. One Bruce play, Preaching versus Practice, expressed Garvey's hostility toward unscrupulous black preachers. Another, Which One, provided an excellent example of the use of this medium for political education. The main characters were a Senabundu Ajay, an African UNIA diplomat, and three young ladies, one each from Martinique, the British West Indies, and Afro-America, all of whom were in love with the hero, who was leaving for Nigeria on UNIA organizational business. In between the romantic escapades, the audience was treated to monologues extolling the virtues of the UNIA. The set was liberally decorated with the red, black, and green of the UNIA, and the hero and the lady of his choice eventually announced their intention to be married in a Liberty Hall in Africa. Garvey himself indulged in political playwriting. His The Coronation of the African King was performed at his Edelweiss Park headquarters in Jamaica in 1930. The three-act play included scenes in New York, Washington, Paris, London, the West Indies, Ashanti, Dahomey, Senegal, and the Sudan. One scene showed the French Premier and British Prime Minister David Lloyd George conferring over UNIA penetration into Africa. Another featured black voices delivering stirring oratory against a backdrop of African freedom fighters engaged in bloody struggle with French usurpers in the Sudan. The whole play was conceived as a dramatization of the results of UNIA propaganda since 1918. Such cultural activity was widely indulged in throughout the UNIA. The Dominica Division had a literary club. The Black Cross Nurses in Norfolk, Virginia, in 1922, staged an African convention, a play which was full of race pride and was staged to enthuse the public on the aims of the UNIA and ACL. In Newport News, Virginia, at about the same time, the juvenile Black Cross nurses and Boy Scouts put on a short play, Coming Home to Africa. In New York, the UNIA Dramatic Club performed the great race drama, Talibu, designed to interpret the ideas of this great association. The Philadelphia division sponsored The New Negro, described as a genuine Negro melodrama. The Negro World commented on the play, "The old Uncle Tom type is shown as a servant of the Honorable Marcus Garvey, while the new Negro stands up man to man in the sun of Marcus Garvey and demands an equal break with other races." Garvey's heyday in the 1920s coincided with the Afro-American literary efflorescence known as the Harlem Renaissance, for the race and Africa consciousness of which Garvey himself was in no small way responsible. Indeed, some of the most important artists of the Renaissance were associated with the UNIA. Claude McKay was a Garvey supporter and a regular contributor to the Negro World in its early period. Eric Walrond was a Negro World editor, and Zora Neale Hurston was a columnist for the paper. Negro World readers were treated to excellent book reviews by editors William H. Ferris, Eric Walrond, and Hubert H. Harrison. Yet, Garvey could not uncritically accept the exoticism and exaggerated negritude which sometimes characterized writers of the period. He accordingly joined in the chorus of criticism against Claude McKay's Home to Harlem. Writing from France, he disapproved strenuously of Black writers who were prostituting their intelligence under the direction of the white man to bring out and show up the worst traits of our people. He considered McKay's book a damnable libel against the Negro and postulated his conception of the type of artist the race needed. "We must encourage our own Black authors who have character, who are loyal to their race, who feel proud to be Black, and in every way let them feel that we appreciate their efforts to advance our race through healthy and decent literature." The Negro World, in similar vein, took County Cullen, another luminary of the Harlem Renaissance, to task. The paper deplored the fact that a Harvard graduate could overdo the nigritude idea to the extent of writing, "Not yet has my heart or head in the least way realized it and I are civilized." During UNIA international conventions in New York and Jamaica, a literary censor was recommended who would safeguard Black people from material unfavorable to the race. During the latter half of the 1930s, Garvey increasingly focused his attention on Paul Robeson, the leading Black motion picture actor of the period. Garvey paid due homage to Robeson's artistic ability, but did not like the spectacle of the foremost Black dramatic personality of the age being cast in a series of roles calculated to demean Black folk. Robeson was reported in 1929 to be the projected star of a satire on Garvey's career, written by two authors, Wallace Thurman and Willard Rapp, known for their sensationalism of Harlem's seamier side. Whether this had anything to do with Garvey's attitude is unclear. The play was to be titled Jeremiah the Great. At any rate, 1935 found Garvey denouncing Robeson's appearances in such well-known stage and motion picture productions as Emperor Jones, Sanders of the River, and Stevedore. Readers of Garvey's Black Man magazine were informed that Paul Robeson, the Negro actor, has left London for Hollywood. He has gone there to make another slanderous picture against the Negro. The point was made that in days gone by, any Black man who succeeded in white circles was automatically lionized. That day should be no more. The hope was expressed that Robeson was now making sufficient money, so that when he retires from the stage, he may be able to square his conscience with his race by doing something good for it. In 1937, Garvey protested to the British Broadcasting Corporation against anti-black programs and to the British Moving Picture Board against Robeson's films. While in 1939, 1 year before his death, he actually published a critical pamphlet aimed at Robeson's films. Robeson withdrew from Hollywood the same year for the same reasons contained in Garvey's criticisms. Garvey's concern with the racial implications of culture embraced also vaudeville. The UNIA-owned Two Follies companies in Jamaica, various UNIA choirs and bands, such as the Universal Jazz Hounds of the Jamaica UNIA, and sports, where Garvey expressed keen interest in the wider implications of the Joe Louis versus Max Schmeling bouts of the late 1930s. Outstanding black talent in any field was always welcome at Liberty Hall. Women's Day at the 1922 convention featured Marian Anderson of Philadelphia, billed as America's greatest contralto soloist. Garvey's doctrine of race first was severely tested by the presence within the race of large numbers of persons of mixed African and Caucasian origin. He took the position that there is more bitterness among us Negroes because of the cast of color than there is between any other peoples, not excluding the people of India. He even asserted that prejudice within the race probably exceeded that directed against the race by alien races. This position brought Garvey into serious ideological conflict with middle-class leaders in the United States and the West Indies, many of whom were themselves of lighter hue. Such opposition was particularly hostile in the United States, where integrationist leaders such as W.E.B. Du Bois argued that this problem either did not exist or was relatively minor in the United States, and that Garvey, because of his West Indian background, was erroneously importing this feature of island society into an Afro-American scene that he did not understand. Garvey had indeed come out of a West Indian society stultified by an exaggerated three-tiered system of white, brown, black social stratification, and he himself regularly discussed the problem from at least as early as 1913. His Jamaican daily, The Black Man, editorialized in 1929, "Some people are afraid, some annoyed, and others disgusted that we, as they say, raise the color question." The question has long ago been raised and put into vindictive operation. The color question is the one and only reason that we cannot find a black girl or boy in store or office in this city when, to our certain knowledge, intelligent ones among them have been refused at places filled with half-illiterate brown and mulatto girls and boys affecting the attitude of superiors in behavior. There is going to be fair play in this country yet. The black man is on the job and soon will blacken some of these stores and offices beyond recognition. As the editorial suggests, even in Jamaica, where the color caste distinctions were acute, the tendency of the brown class was to deny its existence, much as Du Bois and the Afro-American integrationists did. But Garvey was relentless in his attempts to bring the issue to the surface. "This hypocritical cry of peace, peace, when there is no peace, is ruinous to the peace and harmony of society," he declared. "We deny the existence of a condition that is woven into the warp and woof of the fabric of our social and public life. We refuse to admit the presence of a feature in our national life, the inescapable results of whose insidious workings cause delay, irritation, and annoyance. We rave against, we forbid, we threaten those who dare to refer to the evident, the patent facts, and their glaring results, while the whole land is leavened and permeated with the evils of color distinction, and we cry out for harmony and peace. We are, to use a vulgar phrase, a bunch of cheats. We are dishonest, immoral, liars, hypocrites. This type of assault on entrenched privilege brought Garvey a death threat from a self-styled Jamaican secret society of colored men, which considered him a black swine. In Afro-America, too, Garvey observed a preference among employers for light-skinned people as clerks, waitresses, etc., and newspapers full of advertisements for skin whiteners, often couched in the crudest possible language. Added to this, he discovered in New York, Boston, Washington, and Detroit, the Blue Vein Society and the Colonial Club. The West Indian Lights formed the Colonial Club, and the American Lights, the Blue Vein Society. These attitudes extended into the churches. It would appear then that Garvey, as one of his supporters pointed out, did not appeal to intra-race color prejudice in the United States, but rather revealed it. Despite the similarities, of course, the situation in America, where the majority did not need the support of the buffer mulatto element to the same extent as the white minority in the islands, was not as serious as in the West Indies. Garvey was fully aware of this. The situation in America was serious enough to warrant exposure and attack, but in the West Indies, it more nearly approximated a rigid caste structure. Garvey himself pinpointed this difference better than any of his critics. In the term Negro, we include all those persons whom the American white man includes in this appellation of his contempt and hate. The contents of the term are much reduced in Jamaica and the West Indies, but it carries no less of reprobation against the persons. The great curse of our Jamaica communal life is the failure of the hybrid population to realize their natural and correct identification. So whereas the UNIA in the United States numbered among its ranks people of all colors, excluding whites, and business and professional people in addition to the great mass of workers and peasants, in Jamaica, it was largely confined to the humbler sections of humanity. This led Garvey to surmise that God seems to save from the bottom upwards. Garvey's experience with the light-skinned element, both in the West Indies and America, led him to be hostile toward those who seemed to portray the supercilious attitudes he abhorred. It led him, too, to consider miscegenation to be an evil which should not be perpetuated. We are conscious of the fact that slavery brought upon us the curse of many colors within our race, but that is no reason why we of ourselves should perpetuate the evil. The doctrine of race first had various implications for Garvey's attitude toward white people. It meant, first of all, the exclusion of white people from membership in the UNIA and affiliated organizations. Whites were also prevented from holding shares in Garvey's economic undertakings. His desire to build racial self-reliance led logically to the rejection of white financial philanthropy. In reply to a suggestion by a white reporter in 1921 that certain Negrophiles in Massachusetts might be prevailed upon to contribute to the UNIA, Garvey replied, "We do not want their money. This is a black man's movement." Race first meant, however, not only race first for black people, but for other races as well. As far as Garvey was concerned, white people of whatever political persuasion put race before all other considerations. Accordingly, he often preferred an honest expression of racism to the possibly transparent smiles of the philanthropist. He looked at the honest expression of racism as a blessing in disguise because it forced the black man into a heightened racial consciousness, whereas the camouflaged variety could lull him into a sense of false security. Commenting in 1917 on the great strides Afro-Americans had made in independent racial endeavor, he wrote, "The honest prejudice of the South was sufficiently evident to give the Negro of America the real start, the start with the race consciousness, which I am convinced is responsible for the state of development already reached by the race. Thus, he could say, we have to admire the white man who fixed the Bible to suit himself, and who even fixed tradition itself, telling us that everything worthwhile and beautiful was made by the white man, that God is a great white man, that Jesus was a white man, and that the angels, etc., whatever they are as beautiful as peaches in Georgia. By the same token, however, he saw white self-interest as largely detrimental to black self-interest. And within the confines of a country such as the United States, where whites formed a large ruling majority, white racial self-interest would tend inexorably toward the extermination of the black minority. These considerations strengthened Garvey's commitment to racial separation. Despite the fact that Garvey would not accept white philanthropy or allow whites to join his organization, it did not follow that he could not work to a limited extent with white people. In fact, by maintaining an independent black power base, he had more freedom to work with or support widely differing types of white persons and organizations on specific projects or for limited objectives than some of his contemporaries who were straitjacketed in interracial organizations. The first category of white people with whom Garvey could cooperate were certain types of radicals, usually those engaged in anti-colonial, anti-imperialist, or anti-racist struggles. Often they were leaders of mass movements like his own, and he could identify them as kindred spirits. Among persons in this category were Eamon de Valera, the Irish leader who, on one occasion, was listed as a featured speaker at Garvey's Harlem Liberty Hall, and the Russian revolutionaries, Lenin and Trotsky. He often had a good word for historical figures such as John Brown, Elijah Lovejoy, and others of abolitionist inclination. He also had great admiration for Captain A.A. Cipriani, white leader of the Trinidad Working Men's Association, TWA, whose public career largely coincided with Garvey's in time and political outlook. Cipriani had become head of the TWA in 1919 at the invitation of the members, who were black. By this time, the association had already become a Garveyite stronghold in Trinidad, and its struggles were being reported in the Negro world. Many of its meetings were held in Port of Spain's Liberty Hall, and its second-in-command, W. Howard Bishop, as well as other members of its hierarchy, were prominent Garveyites. Garvey corresponded with Cipriani, who made representations to the British government in 1937 to change their intention of barring Garvey from entry into the island. Another well-known white radical for whom Garvey seems to have had some respect was Nancy Cunard, renegade member of a wealthy shipping family who became involved in a variety of black causes. In 1932, Cunard visited Jamaica to gather material for her Negro anthology and was the guest at a reception arranged by Garvey. If Garvey could associate with some radical whites of the left in deference to their anti-imperialist stance or reputation as leaders of the masses, he could also associate, for different reasons, with segregationists on the far right. These latter shared one very crucial ideological tenet with Garvey. They, too, believed in race first and, therefore, in the separation of the races. Despite Garvey's limited agreements with some white persons, however, the insistent black nationalist thrust of the UNIA ensured the hostility of the majority of whites. One white lady witnessing a UNIA parade on 125th Street in Manhattan in 1920 is said to have tearfully exclaimed, "And to think, the Negroes will get their liberty before the Irish." Garvey's race-first doctrine was essentially a stratagem to ensure self-reliance and equality for the downtrodden African race. Unlike the white preachers of this doctrine, with whom he collaborated, he did not go a step further and preach racial superiority. He more than once stressed that all beauty, virtue, and goodness are the exclusive attributes of no one race. All humanity have their shortcomings. Hence, no statement of mine at any time must be interpreted as a wholesale praise of or attack upon any race, people, or creed. Self-reliance was a necessary corollary to race first. In his earliest extant pamphlet, Garvey explained, in terms showing the probable influence of Booker T. Washington, that the Negro is ignored today simply because he has kept himself backward. But if he were to try to raise himself to a higher state in the civilized cosmos, all the other races would be glad to meet him on the plane of equality and camaradership. He went on to express an idea which would later cause him much enmity from Afro-American integrationists. It is indeed unfair to demand equality when one of himself has done nothing to establish the right to equality. Garvey never abandoned this dual tendency to score the white race for its injustice while simultaneously utilizing the language of condemnation to spur the black race on to greater self-reliance. Garvey's belief in the necessity for self-reliance led him occasionally to speak in the language of social Darwinism. He attacked the pseudoscientific racists who tried to justify genocide against black people in terms of the Darwinian survival of the fittest and turned their arguments to the cause of racial self-reliance. White philosophers, he argued, Darwin, Locke, Newton, and the rest, forgot that the monkey would change to a man, his tail would drop off, and he would demand his share. And not only had these philosophers been mistaken, but black heroism in World War I had finally given the lie to such false assumptions. He reminded his black audiences that theory has been exploded in the World War. It was you, the Superman, that brought back victory at the Marne. The urgency Garvey felt for racial independence and self-reliance led him to argue that in independent endeavor lay the only hope of eventual solution to the problem of race prejudice. The white race would cease its aggressiveness toward the black when it was met by independent black power of a magnitude equal to its own. White prejudice was manifested not because there is a difference between us in religion or in color, but because there is a difference between us in power. Furthermore, Garvey believed that the black man had little choice in the matter. If he did not continue going forward, spurred on by his own efforts, then he would slide backward into slavery and even extermination. These days of slavery are not gone forever, he reminded his followers. Slavery is threatened for every race and nation that remains weak and refuses to organize its strength for its own protection. The most important area for the exercise of independent effort was economic. Garvey believed, like Washington before him, that economics was primary. Successful political action could only be founded on an independent economic base. After a people have established successfully a firm industrial foundation, he wrote, they naturally turn to politics and society, but not first to society and politics, because the two latter cannot exist without the former. Within months of his arrival in the United States in 1916, Garvey was already appraising, with approval, the efforts Afro-Americans had made in the economic field. At this early period, before he had made his decision to remain in the United States, he wrote, in a vein having prophetic implications for his own career, the acme of American Negro enterprise is not yet reached. You have still a far way to go. You want more stores, more banks, and bigger enterprises. I hope that your powerful Negro press and the conscientious element among your leaders will continue to inspire you to achieve. This desire for economic self-reliance dominated Garvey's thought. The fact that the black man was a consumer and not an independent producer worried him. Let Edison turn off his electric light, and we are in darkness in Liberty Hall in 2 minutes, he once said. The Negro is living on borrowed goods. Garvey made a valiant attempt to change this state of affairs. Between 1918 and the early 1920s, Garvey's headquarters area in New York City sprouted a large assortment of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.